Kämpfen mit einem Wille. Befehl, den immer die anderen zu gehorchen haben. Von oben beginnen und ganz unten erst enden.
Adolf Hitler is more closely associated with World War II than any other individual, despite the fact that there were dozens of world leaders involved in the conflict. Is such recognition deserved? Or was he only a small cog in a far larger machine? Was Adolf Hitler personally responsible for triggering the largest, darkest conflict in human history? Adolf Hitler, future Führer of Nazi Germany, was born in April 1889 in a small Austrian village near the German border. His father, Alois, a cold and aloof civil servant, largely ignored his son, while his mother, Clara, doted on him. In school, Adolf proved to be a moody, mediocre student. When his father scolded him for his poor performance in class, Adolf would go to his mother for comfort. Even as a child, Hitler knew how to manipulate people to get what he wanted. At the age of 18, Adolf moved to Vienna, ostensibly to enroll in the Academy of Fine Arts. When his application was rejected, he drifted from job to job, living off a small inheritance left to him by his mother. Much of his time was spent in bars and coffee houses frequented by radical philosophers. Here, in the supercharged atmosphere of turn-of-the-century politics, he heard and absorbed theories about racial purity, anti-Semitism, and fanatical nationalism. Years later, Hitler would recall, "Vienna was a hard school for me, but it taught me the most influential lesson in life." In 1914, with World War I looming on the horizon, Hitler moved to Munich, where he enlisted in the German army. When war came, Adolf Hitler found his first real interest. Serving as a courier in the frontline trenches, he was wounded once and decorated twice. The horrible excitement of war, the tension, thrilled him more than anything he'd ever known. When the war ended in November 1918, Germany was left humiliated, bankrupt and leaderless by the crushing peace terms imposed on it by the victorious French, English, Americans and Italians. Personally embittered by the loss of the war and his thrilling years at the front, Hitler eventually found work as a police spy, assigned to infiltrate the radical political groups that were forming all over Germany. Of the many groups he spied on, some communist, some ultra-right wing, the one he found most intriguing was the German Workers' Party. In September 1919, Hitler resigned from the police and became a full-time party member. Plotting and planning with his new friends, his leadership abilities soon placed him at the forefront of the tiny movement. In 1920, the party renamed itself the National Socialist German Workers' Party, the acronym Nazi serving as their popular name. Now the head of the party in all but name, Hitler helped compose a 25-point program laying out their goals and aims. Integral to this program was rebuilding a shattered Germany, renouncing the peace treaty that brought the country to its knees, and wreaking vengeance on the countries which had imposed the unfair peace. Unannounced, but often discussed, were the same theories of racial purity, including a hatred of Jews and Slavs, particularly Poles and Russians, that Hitler had learned a decade earlier in Vienna. By 1923, Hitler, now the undisputed party leader, organized a personal bodyguard known as the Schutzstaffel, or SS. Backed by the Nazi Party, the SS and an army of street thugs known as the Brown Shirts, or SA, Hitler and former World War I General Erich Ludendorff launched an attempted takeover of the government in November 1923. Known as the Beer Hall Putsch, the uprising failed. Hitler was wounded and, along with other conspirators, was tried and sentenced to 9 months in prison. Never one to waste time, Hitler used his incarceration to dictate his personal political manifesto. One of the philosophies he expounded was that to keep a nation unified, people must be made to believe they had two enemies, one inside of the country and another outside, both working to destroy the nation. But while Hitler was organizing his thoughts, the virtually leaderless Nazi Party was falling apart. On his release in 1925, the book he had written in prison, Mein Kampf, or My Struggle, was published, while Hitler undertook the job of reorganizing the Nazi Party. Playing on waves of discontent and fear that were surging through Germany, Hitler quickly identified the two enemies he would use to unify the people. An upsurge of anti-Semitism sweeping the nation made the Jews an obvious choice for an internal enemy. While fear of being taken over by communists, who'd so recently seized control in Russia, provided a perfect external enemy. Hitler's fiery rhetoric, which skillfully played on the fears of the German people, brought hundreds and then thousands of new members into the party. With their new backing, the Nazi Party quickly gained a minority standing in the National Assembly, the Bundestag. In the 1932 elections, Hitler ran a close second in the presidential race against the 85-year-old Paul von Hindenburg, garnering 30% of the votes to Hindenburg's 50%. In an attempt to placate the rabble-rousing Nazis, Hindenburg offered Hitler the office of Chancellor and gave cabinet posts to three other Nazi Party members. All might have gone well, except that in August 1934, Hindenburg died at the age of 87. Seizing the moment, Hitler, who already had near dictatorial power, announced that he was combining the posts of Chancellor and President into a single office. He would now simply be known as the leader, or in German, Führer. Also included in the new office was the position of Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces, and all members of the military were required to take a personal oath of loyalty to Hitler. To placate those in the country who were worried about the power of their new Führer, Hitler insisted that Germany only needed two forces to make it great again. himself and the people. To prove his point, he set out on a massive rebuilding of the economy, mostly through illegal construction of armaments and enlargement of the military. While the people were busy rebuilding their shattered nation, Hitler and his inner circle laid plans to expand Germany's borders and settle accounts with enemies both old and new, real and imagined. Hitler's overall plan was simple. First, reclaim territory stripped from Germany at the end of the First World War, and do so by whatever means necessary. Secondly, he would bring down the wrath of God on France and England for the way they dealt with Germany at the end of the war. And finally, eliminate the entire population of Poland and Russia to give the new Germany endless room to expand. But big plans take time. While the German economy remained fragile, the outside world must not become suspicious. To the world, Hitler spoke endlessly about his peaceful aims. He stressed his goals of unity, peace, and work. He also sought the favor of old friends like Austria and of old enemies like France, Poland, and Great Britain. Through a combination of placating and bullying, he managed to negotiate peace treaties with both Poland and France. For nations who'd been at war with Germany only 15 years earlier and were fully aware that Hitler was violating the peace treaty left and right, it was a stunning political victory. By keeping Europe's leaders alternately charmed and terrified, Hitler gave himself the opportunity to make his first big move. In a deft political maneuver, he engineered a popular vote in the coal-rich Saar region, long a part of Germany. The Saar had been ceded to France following World War I. The vote to rejoin Germany was overwhelming, and before the end of 1935, Germany had annexed the first of its lost territories. By similar manipulation, the entire Austrian nation was convinced that it would be far better off as a part of Hitler's Germany. In March 1938, all of Austria was annexed to the growing Nazi empire. Only 6 months later, Hitler demanded that the Sudetenland, a vast tract that had been ceded to Czechoslovakia after World War I, be returned. Insisting that this would be my last territorial demand in Europe, Hitler made it clear that if the demand was not met, there would be dire consequences. The demand was also a test. The great powers of Europe, all of whom had larger armies than Germany, had every right to refuse. But fear of igniting another war convinced them that it was better to play along with Hitler than fight over the future of Czechoslovakia. British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain said it would ensure peace in our time. In response, Hitler called Chamberlain a tea-drinking old woman.
This morning, I had another talk with the German Chancellor, Herr Hitler. And here is the paper which bears his name upon it as well as mine.
Only when Hitler made his next demand did he encounter resistance. Danzig, a major port on the Baltic Sea, had been handed over to Germany's new peace treaty ally, Poland, at the end of the war. The Poles flatly refused to return Danzig to Germany. Hitler proclaimed Poland's refusal an outrage designed to incite war. In fact, it was just the opportunity he'd been looking for. While publicly stating he was looking for a peaceful solution to the Polish situation, Hitler made his real intentions clear by insisting that the entire Czech nation surrender itself to Germany. Knowing that France and England would not come to its aid, and terrified of a full-scale invasion, the Czech government capitulated. With the Czechs serving as an example of his determination, Hitler said that if Poland would not see reason, it might be necessary to settle accounts for good. While the tense Polish situation simmered, Hitler's foreign minister negotiated a non-aggression pact with the Soviet Union. Although the Slavic people of Poland and Russia were both on Hitler's long-term hit list, he could not afford trouble with Russia at the moment. With the cooperation of Russia assured, on August the 31st, 1939, Hitler announced, "Since the situation in Poland has become intolerable, I have decided upon a solution by force." The next day, September the 1st, the German army invaded Poland without the formality of declaring war. It had been a calculated risk that could drag Germany into a state of war with major European powers. And it was a nervous Adolf Hitler who announced the invasion to his nation. The attack on Poland demonstrated a new type of tactic, designed for quick, deep penetration of enemy territory, aimed more at confusing the enemy than holding fortified positions. The tactic was known as Blitzkrieg, lightning war. Although the Germans quickly overran mile after mile of Polish territory and rounded up tens of thousands of Polish civilians, particularly Jews, Great Britain and France couldn't decide if this was really a war or not. Certainly it wasn't worth becoming involved in. They politely honored their commitments to Poland and declared war on Germany. But tellingly, they did nothing. In only 28 days, a shattered Poland became a satellite of Germany. Elated by the easy victory, Hitler remained wary of France and Great Britain. Eventually, they might still press the war and spoil his plans. On October the 9th, 1939, the Führer issued War Directive 6, which stated in part, "Should it become evident that England and France are not disposed to end the war, I have decided to go on the offensive. 6 weeks later, he added, the defeat of England is essential to final victory. Clearly and simply, Hitler was spelling out the future of Europe. With his long-term goals and the methods needed to achieve them now clear, the following spring, Hitler ordered his armies to attack Denmark and Norway. It was a short, nasty fight, and Germany was the unquestioned victor. When Hitler told his generals they should now move into Belgium and Holland on their way to settling accounts with France, they insisted that such a move would inevitably drag England into the war. Hitler agreed. It was exactly what he wanted. According to War Directive 10 from February 1940, he intended to deny Holland and Belgium to the English, and thereby pave the way for the destruction of the Anglo-French military. Months later, German armies overran the Low Countries and attacked France along its north and northeastern borders. Although the British sent a massive expeditionary force to France's aid, the Belgians and French refused to cooperate sufficiently or react quickly enough to prevent disaster. Within weeks, the Allies were driven back toward the French coast, and Hitler had his next move well prepared. On May the 24th, he proclaimed, "The next objective is to annihilate the French, English, and Belgian forces which are surrounded in Flanders, and seize the Channel coast in this area." With British and French forces surrounded at Dunkirk, Hitler made his first major mistake. There was little doubt that tens of thousands of French and British troops could be wiped out if the battle were forced quickly enough. But Hitler's generals each wanted the honor of the coup de grace. The army insisted they had cornered the enemy, and it was their right to finish the job. Air Marshal Hermann Göring insisted it could be done more efficiently by the Luftwaffe. Hitler vacillated, possibly believing that the British could still be persuaded to sue for peace. Certainly, he would prefer to have the might of the British Empire as a friend rather than an enemy. Whatever the reason, the moment was lost. Before the Germans could finish their grisly work, 340,000 British and French troops had been evacuated across the Channel. Still putting the best face on a bad situation, Hitler was elated at the collapse of France. What Imperial Germany had not been able to do in the 4 years of the First World War, he had done in 6 weeks. In June 1940, Hitler's empire reached its greatest extent. Germany controlled 323,000 square miles of territory and held more than 100 million people in its iron grasp. Hitler even made additional peace overtures to Great Britain, but the new Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, was unwilling to listen. England was more committed to fighting than ever before. Furious at nearly everyone but himself, Hitler swore vengeance on Britain. The summer offensive would be directed almost entirely against the intransigent little island kingdom. In May 1940, Hitler ordered history's most massive bombing campaign. He would destroy the Royal Air Force, the last weapon with which the English could prevent a German landing on British shores. In two war directives, Hitler stated, the English Air Force must be so reduced, morally and physically, that it is unable to deliver any attack against a German crossing of the Channel. The Luftwaffe is to overpower the English Air Force in the shortest possible time. Attacks are to be directed against flying units, their ground installations, supply organizations, and the aircraft manufacturing industry. Although the Battle of Britain was well on its way to success, for reasons that remain obscure, Hitler changed the direction of the attack. Military targets were largely ignored in favor of terror bombing civilian targets. London, Coventry, Birmingham, Liverpool, and other cities were bombed mercilessly for days and nights on end. The devastation and death were awful, but the diversion gave the Royal Air Force time to rebuild and mount a counter-offensive. For the second time in less than 6 months, Hitler had badly miscalculated. The counteroffensive drove German fighters and bombers away from both civilian and military targets and took a massive toll on the Luftwaffe. On September 15, 1940, the RAF scored its largest victory against the onslaught. Having lost more than 180 planes in 4 months, the Luftwaffe was permanently crippled. Germany would have to find other means of dealing with Britain. Had the attack continued to concentrate on military targets, Britain would have had little option but to sue for peace. Ultimately, a neutralized United Kingdom would have denied the Allies a launching pad for an invasion of Europe. But either Hitler failed to realize this, or he believed himself so invincible that no power on earth could successfully stand against him. Of all the mistakes a politician can make, believing in their own rhetoric is undoubtedly the worst. But flushed with one success after another, this is exactly the trap into which Hitler fell. He was the Führer. He had remolded Germany to his will. No leader, no army, no nation on earth could stand in his way. Or so he thought. Although the British situation was a continuing irritation, it did nothing to dampen Hitler's enthusiasm for his plan to expand German territory into Russia. There is little doubt that given time, Russian dictator Joseph Stalin would have attacked Germany. Certainly Hitler was a threat, but Russia was not ready. Russian industry was weak, and the army suffered from a lack of leadership, largely due to massive purges of the high command carried out during the mid to late 1930s. For the time being, Stalin was happy to let Germany wear itself out elsewhere. Fully aware that war with Russia was only a matter of time, Hitler decided he would strike first. When his generals insisted that Germany was overstretched, he reminded them, none too gently, that it was he who had engineered the attacks on Poland, Norway, Denmark, Belgium, Holland, and France. His vision made Germany great. He led the nation. If the generals did not follow his lead, they were cowards and would be replaced. Besides, in Hitler's mind, the Russians were decadent Slavs, less than human. In Hitler's words, one good kick and the whole rotten facade will collapse. The attack on the Soviet Union would commence the following spring, 1941. But the invasion was delayed while German armies were busy overrunning Greece and Yugoslavia, and did not begin until the end of June. Even had Russia collapsed quickly, the country is so vast that it would have taken many months to ferret out the entire army. Fancying himself a fine military historian, Hitler should have known that others, like Napoleon Bonaparte, had tried to conquer it and had all come to grief in the vast and icy Russian landscape. But this fight was not about military practicalities. It was about ideology. The Germans believed themselves superior to the Russian Slavs. They owed it to their future to populate Russia with a purer race. When the invasion of Russian territory finally began on June 22, 1941, the initial phases seemed to prove Hitler right. The Russians put up a poor fight, thousands dying where they stood, underarmed and undertrained. The rest simply pulled back, giving up thousands of square miles of their country to the Germans. Curiously, in mid-August, Hitler decided that Moscow was no longer his prime objective. The main army would redeploy northward and take Leningrad. Thousands of weary soldiers were moved thousands of miles to besiege a relatively unimportant city because Hitler wanted to wipe it from the face of the earth. The generals knew it was a mistake. Time was of the essence, but at this stage, no one dared argue with the Führer. As summer turned to autumn and the rain set in, German troops and equipment became mired in a sea of mud. It should not have taken a genius to see what Stalin was doing. He was playing for time, waiting for Russia's greatest ally, winter. Weeks later, temperatures dropped and the mud turned to ice. Snow buried the roads, farms, forests, and entire armies. Thousands of miles from home, ill-equipped for a protracted war and without winter clothes, the Nazi blitzkrieg froze solid, often within sight of such major objectives as Moscow, Leningrad, and Stalingrad. The generals pleaded with Hitler to allow them to pull back. He adamantly refused. Not one inch of conquered territory would be surrendered. There were places in the Soviet Union where the Germans could have made allies. Many states, like Belarus and the oil-rich Ukraine, resented Stalin's harsh rule and initially greeted the Germans as liberators. But the ideology of Mein Kampf refused to recognize the worth of these potential allies. Consequently, they were brutalized and murdered. By December, Russian forces had redeployed for the first counteroffensive. half-starved German armies were on the edge of revolt, and only harsh disciplinary measures kept them in position. But there was no holding back the Russian armies. It was a desperate situation and was getting worse. If Russia seemed like an ominous foretelling, the situation elsewhere was no better. On December the 7th, 1941, only days before the first Russian counteroffensive began, Germany's ally, Japan, had attacked the US naval base at Pearl Harbor. Hitler was furious at not having been consulted prior to the attack, but decided to back the Japanese by declaring war on the US. Why he did this remains a mystery. He had never had a problem backing out of treaties with his allies before. It was, however, certain that Germany and the US would go to war at some point. America had been piling up men and supplies in England for months, and their intent to mount an invasion of Europe was plain to everyone. Increasingly frustrated that the war was not going according to plan, Hitler took direct control of the army. If the generals could not or would not win the battles, he would have to do it himself. Convinced he was faced with enemies on all sides and on his own staff, he turned his attention to an enemy who could not fight back, the Jews. In January 1942, the final solution was initiated. Concentration camps were thrown up all over Germany and Poland, and millions of civilians were marched off to their deaths. Thank you. Germany was now facing unsustainable demands on its limited military manpower. Huge armies were tied down on the Russian front. Thousands were being rushed to the Atlantic coast to defend against a future Allied invasion. And thousands more were employed in rounding up Jews, communists, gypsies, and other supposed enemies of the state. It was a drain no army could withstand. Surprisingly, despite the cost in manpower, the spring of 1942 went well for Germany. The armies seemed to be holding back the Russians. There was no sign of an Allied invasion. And the death camps were busy ensuring the racial purity of the Reich. But it was a temporary respite. By summer, the British Air Force, supported by the Americans, launched massed air raids on German territory and Germany itself. Early November, German forces in North Africa had been resoundingly beaten by British and American forces. And days later, an entire Russian army attacked German forces which had spent months besieging Stalingrad. Hitler, ever optimistic but increasingly divorced from reality, declared Russia eliminated as a political and military factor. It was a spectacular misstatement. By midsummer 1943, British and American troops, encouraged by their successes in North Africa, invaded Sicily, inciting the Italians to overthrow Hitler's closest ally, Benito Mussolini. Shuffling his dwindling armies in an attempt to shore up the Italian front, Hitler became acutely aware of just how great a threat the Americans and British now posed. In War Directive 51, issued on the 3rd of November 1943, he stated, Everything indicates that the enemy will launch an offensive against the Western Front at the latest in spring. Should they breach our defenses, the consequences would be unpredictable. As a hedge against the invasion, in May 1944, Hitler launched the first of his vaunted secret weapons, which he insisted would turn the tide of war. The first V-1 flying bomb landed on London on May the 16th. But with the Allied invasion only 5 weeks away, it would prove a case of too little, too late. Always nervous and highly strung, by spring 1944, Hitler was rapidly deteriorating physically and mentally. Stomach ulcers sapped his strength and made him increasingly edgy. In meetings and conferences, his behavior became erratic and often violent. He flew into uncontrollable rages, accusing staff members of being incompetent traitors, unfaithful to him and to Germany. Unilaterally, Hitler ordered the movement of entire armies from one location to another in a desperate and often irrational attempt to stave off the inevitable. When the invasion of Normandy finally came on June the 22nd, 1944, it quickly became evident that the Atlantic Wall coastal defenses would not hold. The High Command insisted that the only hope of stopping the Allies was a massive air attack aimed at both those forces already on shore and troop transport ships still in the channel. It was a logical move and exactly what Hitler had called for the previous November in Directive 51. But for reasons that may never be known, no action was taken. Later, Hitler blamed Goering, saying the Air Marshal had been taking a nap and left orders not to be disturbed. But considering the landings took 7 days, this is hardly creditable. In any case, there was no longer any way to save Nazi Germany from defeat. The generals and commanders had lost faith in their Führer. The armies were stretched beyond their limits, and the Luftwaffe was in shambles. Privately, some generals talked of approaching the Allies behind Hitler's back in the hope of staving off total disaster. As US and UK forces surged through France and Belgium, the Russians were preparing for their final push from the Polish border toward Berlin. The last phases of the war brought the full horror of what they had unleashed home to the German people. City after city was bombed day and night, virtually without pause. Refugees clogged the roads, making it ever more difficult for the military to move. Finally, in a desperate attempt to save their country from complete destruction, a group of high-ranking officers made a pact to assassinate Adolf Hitler. In March 1943, a bomb placed on his personal plane had failed to explode. But this time, they would not fail. On the 20th of July 1944, a suitcase bomb placed under a conference table where Hitler was addressing staff officers went off, practically tearing the building apart. But somehow, Hitler walked away with little more than scratches and an unquenchable thirst for revenge. More than 5,000 men who'd been involved or were suspected of being involved in the plot were executed in the most horrible manner the Gestapo could devise. Films of their suffering were served to Hitler along with his dinner for weeks on end. Now, fearing almost everyone outside his inner circle, Hitler rarely appeared in public. Increasingly, he directed what was left of his forces from a bunker deep beneath Berlin's Chancellery building. But by September, when the Americans crossed the German border and entered the heartland of the Reich, even Hitler had to admit the impossibility of bringing up adequate reinforcements do not allow us to determine a line which can be held. He could only demand that the army dispute every inch of ground by stubborn delaying action. By the time the Russians crossed the border in January 1945, Germany was exhausted. Every male between the ages of 16 and 65 had been called into service. And the nation was reduced to ruin. Berlin, Hamburg, Dresden, Cologne, and dozens of other cities were little more than vast fields of rubble. Furious that the Germans had neither the will nor the strength to conquer the world, in March 1945, Hitler ordered the destruction of everything left standing in Germany. If he could not rule Germany, there would be no Germany left for anyone else to rule. As a final tribute to the officers who'd fought so hard, in early April, Hitler told his surviving troops, "Anyone ordering you to retreat will be immediately shot on the spot, no matter what rank he may hold." The Führer's orders had become so irrational that only the most fanatical Nazis bothered to listen to them. Most officers were too busy trying to save their men's lives to concern themselves with Hitler's insanity. While troops and civilians scurried to surrender to the Allies rather than be taken by the Russians, and bureaucrats burned every record they could find, Hitler wandered the corridors of his bunker whistling a tune from a Walt Disney movie, "Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf?" On April the 30th, 10 days after his 56th birthday, Adolf Hitler, Führer of Nazi Germany, committed suicide. 8 days later, Germany surrendered unconditionally. The stunned citizens of Berlin wandered aimlessly amongst the ruins. For them, almost 6 years of war had left them with little more than rubble, fear, and a foreboding uncertainty of their future. Had Germany won the war, the credit would certainly have gone to Adolf Hitler. He had planned for it, plotted it out in detail, and directly or indirectly, been responsible for the death of 35 million people.